begin the session, we prayed that beautiful prayer, the Hail Mary, the prayer to our Blessed Mother. And we are all people who do find the life of Mary inspirational, and that is why we recite that prayer. The one person we can relate to is our Blessed Mother. The one person we feel one with is our Blessed Mother. And she definitely is given her glory by her Son. Definitely given, and rightly so, given her glory by her Son. And her life is glorious, don't you think that? Yes, her life is glorious. Everything to be the mother of the Son of God, that's beautiful. To be called as the Blessed Virgin, that's beautiful. The upteen number of names that we call her, exalted names we give her, Mother of the Rosary, the Immaculate Conception, and all these beautiful names are quite glorious, and it seems quite good. Isn't it true? Now let me ask you, how will Jesus come in his second coming? What is your answer? I can't hear you. King of Kings, Lord of Lords, in all his glory, the Lord will come. Let's just twist this a bit. What if Jesus is coming in the normal way he came in the Bible, as a little infant, being born of a woman, and that is how the second coming is going to be, if at all it is going to be that way. Let me ask the women over here, how many of you would love to be the mother of Jesus in the second coming? You know, raise your hands. None of you. How many of you would love to be? What if the Lord came and told you, or the angel Gabriel came and told you, you will be the mother of the second coming of Jesus? How many of you women would like to be the mother of Jesus? How many like that privilege? Raise your hands. Okay, praise the Lord. The men need not raise their hands for this. Praise the Lord. Dear brothers and sisters, it looks glorious. It looks nice. And listening to the glory that the Blessed Mother is giving, it feels nice. But it's good to look into ourselves, or look into really what happened, to understand and see, did Mary's life, was it actually glorious? Was Mary's life actually glorious? No, it wasn't glorious. It was filled with pain. It was filled with sorrow. It was filled with a lot of confusion. It was filled with a lot of brokenness. Then why is it that today when we look at her life, we feel that her life is so glorious? Why is it that we look at the portrayal of the Blessed Mother and we feel inspired? I would say it's more because of the way she approached her motherhood. The way she approached her motherhood. The Bible tells us about how Angel Gabriel comes to the Blessed Mother and gives that big declaration, you will conceive a child, and the child will be born of the Holy Spirit, and he will be called Emmanuel, the Son of God. Praise the Lord. He will be called Emmanuel. He will be called the Son of God. Dear brothers and sisters, it does sound very nice. An angel coming, getting a vision, and all that light. The angel with the wings, and so beautiful, that all this looks and sounds nice. How many of you would love to have a vision of an angel? Can you raise your hands? Yes, praise the Lord. You know, all of you raise your hands. The Lord sees what you want, and the Lord gives according to that. Praise the Lord. So we would definitely love to have that beautiful vision. We would definitely love to see an angel. angel, but in all that glory that was there, the fact remains, the message was very disturbing. The message was very disturbing for a young woman of her age. Why was Mary chosen to be the mother of Jesus? Why was she chosen? Why would God choose Mary? Why would anyone choose Mary? Yes, her immaculate conception, that means her purity. Her purity. And she was so pure in mind, in body, in soul. And that is why she was chosen as the mother of God. But dear brothers and sisters, mind you, the choice was made precisely because of her purity. In that case, when an angel comes and tells her that she will conceive of the Holy Spirit and she's pregnant without getting married to someone, what are the others going to question? What are the people going to question? They're going to question her purity. They're going to question her purity. And that is when it becomes disturbing for a young woman. Everyone's going to question her purity. Everyone's going to ask, from where did this child come? If one fine day, like I said, some of you said you would love to be the mother of the second coming of Jesus. If one fine day the angel comes and tells you, you will conceive of the Holy Spirit, and you go outside to the others and say, you know, this is of the Holy Spirit, how many are going to believe you? In today's society, we won't believe how much more difficult it was for the Blessed Mother. Everyone would question her purity. But quietly, what does she say?
Behold, the handmaid of the Lord.
Let it be done unto me according to your word. And dear brothers and sisters, being the mother of God, we would expect at least a bit of preferential treatment for her. But what did she get? From the moment she had that conception, she was busy fleeing from place to place. And we read very clearly, one of the first actions she does after the conception of her son is the visitation. The visitation, she goes and visits her cousin Elizabeth. Praise Lord. Hallelujah. I can't hear you. Hallelujah. 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 Are you awake?
Yes.
Praise Lord. You know, nowadays it's very difficult because many people have developed the art of opening the eyes and going off to sleep. And that's a very amazing art, to be able to open your eyes and go off to sleep. And I know we used to do that a lot in the seminary. When the classes used to go on, we used to keep our eyes open but we were sleeping. And they always say, whatever you do in life will one day come back to haunt you. And that is why I'm scared that one day it will come back to haunt me like this. Are you awake?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So one of the first things that she did was the visitation. She made that difficult journey to her cousin Elizabeth. Dear brothers and sisters, mind you, there were no cars, there was no road. It would take months to just make that visit, that journey, and come back. She made it in spite of herself being pregnant with a child. Nowadays, when women get pregnant, in the second month itself, they are on bed rest. Till the 9 months, they are on bed rest. I remember a mother come and tell me, actually a mother-in-law come and tell me about her daughter-in-law. She was complaining. She said, Father, all the time she's been on bed rest from the third month of the pregnancy. And she said, the doctors had told her you'd be on bed rest. She's taken it up very fast. She's lying down all the time. She does no work at home at all. She's become a burden for me. And I said, don't worry, after all, it is for the sake of your grandchild. So the mother-in-law said, yes, that's the only reason I'm keeping quiet. A year or so later, This lady came, this mother-in-law came with this tiny baby, showed me the baby and said, "Father, see my little grandson." And I was happy, I blessed the child. And then I asked, "Where is the mother?" And she said, "The mother is still in bed rest. Preparation for the next child." Well, that must have been a little mother-in-law, daughter-in-law tiff. But still, once our modern age, once the conception comes in, everyone is on rest. Mother Mary made that journey all the way to her cousin Elizabeth. It was not easy. It was difficult. And she took up that difficulty. And later we see, after the birth of Jesus, in abject poverty, she didn't have a place to give birth to her child. She didn't even have clothes to give her child. The Bible tells us in Luke chapter 2, in Luke chapter 2 verse 7, we read how the Blessed Mother wraps her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger. Praise the Lord. She wrapped him in bands of cloth. How many of you are mothers over here? Can you raise your hands? All the mothers. Raise it up. Be proud that you're mothers. Yes. When you wrap your child, would you wrap your child in bands of cloth or one piece of cloth? Why would you use one piece of cloth? It's basic common sense. Why would you use one full piece of cloth? It keeps the warmth. It keeps the warmth. Bands of cloth will give gaps in between. And who would use bands of cloth? A person who doesn't have one piece of cloth. And that is why very clearly the Bible tells us she wrapped her child in bands of cloth. She was so poor that she didn't have even one full piece of cloth to wrap her little child. You wouldn't expect this for the mother of God. Some preference she should have been given. But abject poverty, the Bible tells us, even when they are presenting Jesus in the temple, that is in Luke chapter 2 verse 24. Luke chapter 2 verse 24. When they are presenting Jesus in the temple, they have to give a sacrifice. And the sacrifice they ordered was, and they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. So they offered in the temple a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. That is the cheapest presentation that is given in the temple. For the poorest of the poor, that is what was meant. The others would give bulls and ox, or some would give goats. The poorest of the poor would give turtle doves. And they had only that much turtle doves. There is nothing glorious, abject poverty. Being the mother of God, yet she had to go through that poverty. And not only that, as she presented the child in the temple, we read about Prophet Simeon. He looks at the Blessed Mother. What does he tell her? A sword shall pierce your heart. There's nothing good to even listen to. Not only is there abject poverty, there is not even anything good to listen to. A sword will pierce your heart. And all throughout, she lives the life of a refugee. Herod is behind the child. Herod wants to kill the child. What is happening to Mother Mary and Joseph? The Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 2 verse 13. Matthew chapter 2 verse 13. Now after they had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt." Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. dear brothers and sisters, the angel comes and disturbs the sleep of poor Joseph. The man must have been so tired and exhausted, there is no place at all to sleep. With what little place he has, he's trying to sleep. And that is when the angel comes and says, get up, angel. Get up, Joseph. Go, take the mother, take the child, start fleeing. Everywhere they are refugees. Herod is trying to kill the baby. Never does she hear anything good about Jesus. Every time it's difficulties, one after the other it's difficulties. He's growing up. As he grows up, he starts his ministry. When the Lord starts his ministry, the Bible tells us everyone looked at Jesus and they said that he's mad. Which mother would like to hear that? You know, when your children become troublesome, you're called to school because your children are nasty in school. Do you enjoy that experience? Do you enjoy that experience? No, definitely you won't enjoy it. Sitting and listening to everyone telling negative things about your little one, you don't enjoy it. No mother would enjoy it. When the Blessed Mother had to sit through that, all people looked at her and said, your son has gone out of his mind. Some of them said that he's a blasphemer. And for a person who was pure, for a person who was a perfect Jew, for a person who always lived according to the statutes of God, for that kind of a mother, when people made an accusation about a little child, about a child, definitely it would hurt. It was not easy, but she listened to it. She listened to it. And ultimately, they kept on speaking negative things about her, about her son, and in the end, they hung him up on that cross. Stripped, naked, bleeding, broken, on a cross, her son hangs there and dies. Nothing glorious about it. Pain and sorrow. They brought that body down from the cross. They placed it in her hands. She held the body of her son, broken and shattered. Nothing glorious about it. Dear brothers and sisters, in today's terms, Mother Mary's motherhood was a total failure. In today's terms, Mother Mary's, the Blessed Mother's motherhood was a total failure. Her son didn't achieve anything. Her son died a criminal. She had poverty. She had only sorrow. Nothing great about her life. In today's world, anyone would look and say that her life was a miserable failure. But amongst you and me today, we look at her and we glorify the Blessed Mother. We look at her and we glorify what she is. Why? Though her life was filled with brokenness, though her life was filled with sadness, why is it that today you and I can look at the Blessed Mother and think that her life was glorious? I would say for only one reason. Because of her attitude to her brokenness, sorrow, and pain. The way she carried her cross, the elegance with which she carried her cross, that is what makes her different from everyone else. So elegantly she's carried her cross. She's carried her cross so elegantly that today you and I can look at her and feel that in her there is a beautiful model of motherhood. There is a beautiful model of discipleship. Only because she elegantly carried her cross. Today she's an inspiration for you and me. Dear brothers and sisters, no wonder at the very end of his life, Jesus gives the Blessed Mother as a gift to you and to me. In John chapter 19, we read so clearly in John chapter 19, when he looks at his beloved disciple, He looks at his beloved disciple John, and he tells John in 19 verse 26, when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, I always close my eyes and I just keep imagining that blessed moment. At that moment when Jesus stands on that cross, he hangs on that cross, all his hands are stretched out. What is it an indication of? He's telling the world, "I have given you everything. I've given you of myself. Nothing more. Nothing more do I have to give you. I've given you everything. Now the last and final thing that I can give you is my mother. Here, take her. The gift of the Blessed Mother given to you and to me." Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Dear brothers and sisters, the beautiful gift of a blessed mother for you and me. A mother who intercedes for us, a mother who prays for us, a mother who fights battles for us. And that will always be a grace that you and I have received from the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. She intercedes and prays in our brokenness. She intercedes and prays in our sadness. She intercedes and prays in our pain and in our sorrows, because she has been given that duty by the Son of God himself. And this is why today we respect the Blessed Mother. This is why we venerate the Blessed Mother, because she has become a model in discipleship. You know, one of our priests was praying and he specifically asked the Lord, a person who is very gifted in the Holy Spirit, he specifically asked the Lord, "Lord, why is it that Mother Mary is given so much of importance?" And the Lord spoke to him in prayer and said, "When the mother was on this earth, she did everything I asked her to do. Now when she is in my presence, I will do everything she asked me to do." Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We have an intercessor in a mother who will understand pain and sorrow. I remember nearly 2 years back, an elderly couple had come to the retreat center, very worried. And the husband and wife were seated with me, and the husband was weeping. And I asked him why and what the reason of his sorrow was. And he said, he has a grandson who's suffering from leukemia. A small little child, maybe around 7 or 8 years old, but the child is suffering from leukemia. And all his children have gone away from the Catholic Church. And everyone is speaking against the two of them, telling them that if this child is suffering from leukemia, it is because you people are still in the Catholic Church. You give up your Catholic faith and this little child will get healed. And that is how this elderly couple is seated here in front of me. And they told me, "We don't know what to do. We see our little grandson in pain and sorrow and we are feeling guilty. We have started thinking that it is us who is the reason why a child is suffering." And that is when we sat in prayer. And in prayer I told them, "Every day you offer up 4 rosaries for this little child. And every day you be faithful to that rosary and you ask the Blessed Mother to protect." And this couple was at a stage where they were all ready to throw away the statue of the Blessed Mother that is in their house. They are the only ones. They are the only ones in the house who are still in the Catholic faith. And they said, "We are at the verge of going off." And that is when I told them, "You offer these 4 rosaries every day for the sake of that little child." After that, I begin the retreat at the retreat center. I was celebrating a mass. After the mass, we have a session of testimony, when a lot of people come and give their testimonies about how the Lord has worked in their life after they've come to divine. And this lady came up and she took the mic and she started saying, "We came here to this retreat center 2 years back when we were faced with a situation of our little grandson suffering from leukemia. And this priest asked us to say the rosary. And that is when it struck me who this lady was." And then she continued and she said, "We went back and we prayed 4 rosaries every day." And she said, "Just a month after that, when we went for the checkup, the doctors were stunned because they said there is not even a small little trace of leukemia in that little child." Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Dear brothers and sisters, the mother intercedes and prays. That whole family has come back to the Catholic faith now. The whole family has come back to the Catholic faith. Her children have come back to the Catholic faith. Dear brothers and sisters, the Lord knows what we need, and the Lord gave us a mother who will intercede for us. A mother who understands sorrow and pain. A mother who's gone through it herself. It's not that she was in all her glory and she doesn't understand what pain is. It's not that she doesn't understand what sorrow is. She knows what it is. She went through it. Along with her son, she went through it. And that is why Jesus gives her as a beautiful gift to you and to me. And that is why every moment of our life, when we are broken, when we are shattered, let us know in the depths of our heart that we have a mother in heaven praying for us. We have a mother who knows what it means to be broken, and she's interceding unceasingly. She's interceding in the presence of God. And even when we fight our daily battles, especially against sin, ask for the Blessed Mother's intercession. Because the one person who fights against the evil of Satan is the Blessed Mother. And the one person who Satan is afraid of is the Blessed Mother. The Bible tells us in the book of Genesis chapter 3, it tells us very clearly, the woman and Satan will always have that battle. Woman and Satan will always have that battle. And in Revelation chapter 12, verse 1, we read, "A great portent appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. She was pregnant and was crying out in birth pangs in the agony of giving birth. Then another portent appeared in heaven, a great red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 diadems on his head. His tail swept down a third of the stars of heaven and threw them into the earth. Then the dragon stood before the woman who was about to bear a child, so that he might devour her child as soon as it was born. And she gave birth to a son, a male child, who is to rule all the nations with the rod of iron. But a child was snatched away and taken to God and to his throne. And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she was protected," is what the word says. Praise the Lord. The battle, the ongoing battle between Satan and the Blessed Mother. And every moment, this is what happens. The Blessed Mother is having that ongoing battle, protecting her little children, that is you and me. And always have that. When we battle, especially with sin, when we have that battle with sin, know that your mother is praying for you. Know that your mother is there for you, interceding to our Lord, praying for protection at every moment. And the one person Satan is afraid of is the Blessed Mother. I remember when I was very young into my priesthood, not that I'm very old now, but I was only around 4 This girl came and she was sitting with me. We were praying. And very clearly, the Lord was revealing about this girl and a wrong relationship that she has entered into with a man of God. A wrong relationship she's entered into with a man of God. And as I started praying, I had the rosary in my hand. And she looked at me and she told me, move that thing away. And I asked her, it's only the rosary, what's there? And she told me, you move it away. And I kept holding on to it. Her eyes were focused on that rosary all throughout. And that is when I held the rosary and I started praying for her. I put my hands on her. And this girl just tumbled over from the chair. She fell on the ground and she started squirming on the ground like a serpent. Exactly. And this happened in public view. All the counselors were there, all the counseling was going on. And she fell down and we were praying with that rosary. And that is when all the counselors together came, we prayed. And there was a massive deliverance that day in that little girl, that young girl. Her story was this. She never experienced love from her parents, as a result of which she was angry with God because she didn't get love from her parents. So she wanted to take revenge on God. And her idea is destroy a man of God, and that is the revenge I can take against God. Now mind you, to do something so crooked, it doesn't come from a human being. It will come only from the evil one. It will come only from the evil one to do something so crooked. And that is why when we were praying, I was holding the rosary and we were praying, I asked her specifically, I asked her, what about that man of God? That's the question I just put forth. Until that moment, this girl was calmly sitting there looking at the rosary. And at that particular moment, in a very husky voice, a very manly voice, she cried out, that person is my problem. And to tell you the truth, it was such a husky voice that a shiver ran down my spine. And to tell you the truth, I wanted to get up and run off. You have to be fair to me, I was only 4 months a priest. And I was so scared to sit over there, but I couldn't get up and go for only one reason, because all the other counselors were sitting over there. And they would see the assistant director get up and run off when he sees something like this. And I knew that was the only reason I couldn't get up. I sat there and all of us prayed together, holding that rosary. Dear brothers and sisters, total deliverance, to the extent that at the end of the prayer, I gave the rosary I was holding in my hand into her hand. She held it, put it around her neck. There was no problem for her after that. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Dear brothers and sisters, this ongoing battle is always there between the Blessed Mother and Satan. And this is what happens in our life. Whenever Satan is there afflicting us with sin, afflicting us with oppressions from the world, afflicting us with the evil of the world, every moment know within your heart you have a Blessed Mother who is fighting that battle for you. You have a mother who is there with you, strengthening you. Because this mother was not chosen by us. This mother was gifted to us by the Son. It wasn't a choice we made. If it was a choice we made, maybe we could have gone wrong in our choices. But this was a choice made by the Lord Himself. When He looked at John and He said, here is your mother. You know, the Gospel of John is very symbolic. John is the beloved. What is he called? He's called the beloved disciple. He's called the beloved disciple. Dear brothers and sisters, you and I are the beloved of God. You and I are the beloved of God. And that is what the Lord is saying to His beloved. Here is your mother. A gift that I'm giving you. And therefore, the choice was not made by human beings. The choice was made by God The gift was given by God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And she will be interceding, especially for us and for our families. One of the most significant actions of the Blessed Mother took place at the wedding at Cana. A beautiful experience at the wedding at Cana when they ran out of wine. What did Mother Mary go into? What did Mother Mary go into? She went, she told Jesus, they have run out of wine. They have run out of wine. And what did the Lord tell her? Woman, what is it with you and me? If they've run out of wine, so what's your problem? And that's when she looks and she says, it is my problem. My children are having a problem. My family is having a problem. And there in the midst, when everyone else must have just looked around, she ended up interceding and becoming a miracle. You know, I always think of that. I don't know if you've watched a movie called Bruce Almighty. Have you seen that? Anybody seen that movie? Yes. This is the story of the movie Bruce Almighty. We priests also watch movies in between if it's good enough. In India sometimes they have a very, very negative concept. They say, Father, how dare you go for a movie? If it's a good movie that gives a meaning, it's definitely beautiful. I was watching this movie, Bruce Almighty. The story is this. There's this man, Bruce, who's had a lot of problems in his life. Nothing is going right. He's lost his job. He's on the verge of losing his girlfriend. He's lost everything. He has a broken down car. Nothing is happening good in his life. And he's totally shattered. And that is when he looks at God and he says, the whole problem in my life is because of you. Much like we do the same thing. All my problems is because of you. Well, he looked at God and he said, all my problems are because of you. Just because you failed to do your work, that is why I'm struggling here. And he keeps complaining against God. And that is when one day God appears to Bruce, the form of a man. But God appears to Bruce. And God tells Bruce, Bruce, I'm going for a 2-week holiday. And therefore, for 2 weeks, I'm going to give you all my powers. And you're going to be God for 2 weeks. And Bruce saw that, and Bruce was very happy. The powers of God. And he says, no problem, you want to go for your holiday? I have all the powers of God. And Bruce gets all God's powers. And Bruce starts getting all the things that he lost. Gets it back with that power. His job that he's lost, with just one touch, he gets it back. He looks at his old, boring car. He just, with one touch, he makes it into a swanky sports vehicle. He changes everything, gets all the money he wants. He's using all that power for himself. But the problem is, Bruce is doing God's work. And therefore, God gets a lot of prayer intentions. And so Bruce started getting a lot of prayer intentions. And it's all coming through the computer. And he has to answer all these prayer intentions. And initially he sits through one and he's giving it, sits through the second, he's giving it. But it's becoming too much because for God, in 1 minute itself, there are millions and billions of prayer intentions that are going up. And Bruce is not able to cope with the pressure. So he formulates a brilliant idea. He selects all the prayers and he clicks OK to all. But if every prayer is OK'd, there is a problem there. Because if one set of people want rain, the other don't want rain. And if you click OK to both of them, then you have chaos. And suddenly the whole world is in chaos. And nothing is going right, and the whole world is in confusion, and Bruce is totally shattered. And he's sitting over there totally broken, and God appears to Bruce once again. And God tells Bruce a statement. God tells him, miracles, rather be a miracle. Don't try to look for miracles, but rather be a miracle. Dear brothers and sisters, when I read that and I connect it to the wedding at Cana, I always think to myself, Mother Mary became a miracle. She's telling us, do whatever He tells you to. Be faithful to Him. The most beautiful thing about the wedding at Cana is, after that statement, do whatever He tells you to, the miracle starts happening. But we don't read about Mother Mary anymore in that incident. She's done her work. And now she takes side stage. Jesus takes center stage. And that is how it is with every miracle. Mother Mary doesn't take the center stage. She stands at the side and she intercedes every moment. The miracle is always performed by Jesus. But Mother Mary's intercession is always there. And more so for every family. For every family. Dear brothers and sisters, we're all people who go through a lot of family brokenness. I'm sure many of us seated over here have family problems. How many of you have family problems? Can you raise your hands? Well, let me tell you the truth. If you don't have family problems, then there's something wrong with your family. I mean, all of us have family problems. All of us have brokenness in our family. I could be a priest, or you could be a nun, you could be anyone, you could be a very holy person, but the fact remains, all of us have brokenness in our family. And if there is one person interceding for us, it is our Blessed Mother. When the whole world will close their eyes on us, when the whole world will look at the brokenness of our lives, and they might spin gossip, when everyone sees our marriages break down and they sit and gossip, when everyone sees our children go astray and they keep pointing fingers at the wrong that we did rather than comfort us, when everyone keeps doing that, when every person in the world keeps doing that, be assured, out of all that, Mother Mary will stand up for us. And she will go to the presence of her Son and she will intercede. And like was promised, what she has always done what the Lord wanted her to do on this earth, now when she intercedes, the Lord will do what she asks. And when she asks for us, the Lord will do it. Are you going through your marital problems? Give it into the hands of the Blessed Mother. There's no one who can understand marital problems better than the Blessed Mother. She had it tough. It wasn't easy convincing Joseph that she was still conceived of the Holy Spirit. Her marriage was already on the rocks, even before her marriage started. It was a difficult situation. She understands marital problems. Are you going through marital problems? Kneel down in the presence of your Blessed Mother and pray, for she will pray with you. Are you struggling with your child? Maybe your child is not going on the wrong path. You don't know how to bring them back. Maybe they are even struggling with the faith. Maybe they don't want to come to church anymore. They are bored of church. They are bored of prayers. They are bored of the Holy Eucharist. They are getting influenced by the things of the world. And maybe you can see their lives shattering in front of you and you feel helpless about it. Don't think you're alone in that battle. Your mother is there praying for you. Your mother will be there protecting your children. Ultimately, she will lead them back. Maybe today and tomorrow you might not see it, but ultimately, your Blessed Mother will lead them back. We've been in that retreat center. We've had that retreat center in India for the last 20 years. I've been there only 4 years, but one of the most beautiful things I see is especially the youth retreats. The number of youth who come back to Jesus. And it's such a blessed sight. It's such a blessed sight because at the same time we have a couples retreat on the other side where all the parents are sitting crying and praying for their children over there. And on the last day when they come, just like maybe some of you are doing when your children are sitting there, last day when the parents come up to us and say, Father, I cannot believe the change in my child. And that is because there is a mother in heaven interceding and praying for you and me. Always know that in the depths of your heart. Whenever you're broken, whenever you're shattered, just know there is a mother there praying for you. A mother will never abandon her child, however bad they get. Maybe you might even try and push them out of the house to teach them a lesson. But ultimately that heart melts for them. For a mother, the child in front of them is their everything. And that is how it is for our Mother Mary as well. Her heart melts for us. And that is why Jesus gave her to us. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 I just end by telling you a little incident that took place at the retreat center, where a young boy was struggling to overcome his addiction to pornography. I remember him coming to me and telling me, Father, it's so difficult. It's so difficult because I move around with friends who are always into this. And it's so difficult for me to just come out of this. My thoughts have all got perverted. I just cannot look at a woman without lust in my eyes. And that is irrespective of who it is. It could be even my sister standing in front of me, but there is lust in my eyes. And as we sat and prayed, I told him, you pray the rosary. And he looked at me and he said, Father, only that? You know, that's one problem that we have. We want to do something, and only then we get satisfaction. You tell people to pray and they say, and everyone says pray. But that prayer has a lot of power. And I told him, the Lord is telling you, you pray the rosary. And he looked at me and said, Father, I have doubts. I have doubts that that can help me because I've tried every kind of prayer, Father, and I don't think anything will change. I told him, if the Lord has said something, the Lord means it. We finished that counseling in barely 3-4 minutes. He walked off. And he came for another youth retreat. He came to me and he asked me, Father, do you recognize me? And I have to be honest, I told him I cannot recognize you. And he said, do you remember the person who kept telling you that the rosary is not going to make any effect on my thought patterns? I told him, yes, now I remember. And he said, Father, a miracle. Because now I don't have any impure thoughts. I've been addicted to pornography for more than 7 to 8 years. But as I've started saying the rosary, there's not even been one day where I even feel a temptation towards going back into that filthy habit. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Dear brothers and sisters, when your children are struggling, tell them about a mother who cares for them. At that moment, they might look at you and tell you, we don't believe in all this. It's okay. Still tell them about the Blessed Mother. Because in times in life when they are broken and shattered and they feel lonely, your voice of what you've asked them to do will come back to them. In moments when they're totally lonely, especially when their friend circles, they abandon them, they betray them, and they feel so broken and hurt. Instead of going into things like alcohol, instead of going into things like drugs, or even instead of thinking of suicide, the first thought that will come to their mind is, we have a mother, let's pray. And it becomes important, you tell your child to pray the rosary. When you sit as a family, tell your children to pray the rosary. They might react initially. It's okay, it's fine. It's a youth reaction. Don't worry about it. But don't stay away from telling them just because they react that way. Tell them it is a seed that you're putting in the heart. When the seed sprouts, that is left up to God. But it will sprout at the right time. If you have faith in the power of God, and if you have faith in the intercession of our Blessed Mother. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. For a moment, let's all close our eyes. this at this moment, pray and ask for the intercession of the Mother of God. God's gift to me is my Blessed Mother. I did not choose, but God chose. And the choices of God will never go wrong. Are you struggling with physical ailments at this moment? Make the prayer. Make a prayer asking for that healing. Is there anything you want to specifically pray for? You pray asking for that healing. Ask for the intercession of the Blessed Mother. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and in the hour of our death. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.